Hi everyone, so welcome to our class today. Today we'll talk about arrays. Let me share my screen. Okay, so today's lecture, as I said, will be on arrays. In Blackboard, you will find a sample exam. Next class, we'll have our first midterm of the semester announced in the syllabus. I saw that about 80% of you tried the sample midterm that was published. I put it right on top. The rest of the 20% of students, please click on the midterm and try to solve it. This is not graded. This is just for you to install and make sure that you can run Lockdown Browser properly and you can take the exam on Tuesday. We'll also take a look later today after the lecture at the questions. But basically, the questions are very straightforward. They are from types and they are multi-choice questions. You also have some fill-in-the-blank questions, operations. Some questions later, you will see in the sample exam that they are to actually write an output. So you are given a question, like for instance, transform these binary numbers into a decimal and is doing an exact match. And after the exam, you can actually go to the attempt after we finish grading it and you will see the feedback. How does it compute that specific number? Okay, either that you did it correctly or you did it incorrectly. For this kind of questions, there is no partial credit, unfortunately. Basically, you either do it correctly and you get the credit for the question, or you made a mistake somewhere, but we can't actually check how you did the mistake since basically only thing that we are asking for is the result. We have to be very precise as computer scientists. The only questions that may have partial credit are the implementation questions. So this is one implementation question on arrays. We'll talk about arrays today. It asks for a method to rotate right an array, a number of positions n. So let's talk about arrays and then I can take questions about the midterm exam that is coming on Tuesday. Tuesday at during class time, instead of joining the Zoom for the class, you will join Lockdown Browser and you will take the exam at 4:45. Okay, so during the exam, at the time of the exam, if you go to assignments Blackboard, on the bottom of the page you will find your exam and it will be available for 80 minutes. No matter when you actually enter in the exam, you will have 80 minutes to finish it. Okay, I will be available on the Google Meet in case that you encounter problems. I set up in such a way the exam that if you lose connectivity or the browser crashes or anything happens, you can go back and you can finish the exam in one attempt. We will try to grade the exam on the same day and make the dates, the grades available on Piazza, maybe on Wednesday, the next day. Okay. For taking the exam, download the Lockdown Browser from the Stony Brook website. You also will get a link to download it in the sample exam. So basically when you try to take the sample exam that is posted on Blackboard on the top, 80% of you already were successful in taking this. So it's really for the rest of you that didn't try to do it by yesterday. The same sample exam is available also for download here. So basically, if you want to see the questions after you took the sample exam, you can basically take the Word document and go over the questions. There are actually more questions in this Word file than there are in the sample exam. I just didn't have enough time to transfer them all into that. The goal of the sample exam is just that you are able to take an exam. It's not going to be graded or anything like that.
Okay. Professor?
Yeah, go ahead.
Quick question. Does the sample exams format match the midterm exams format?
Yes. Basically, there will be questions that are multi-choice questions, fill-in-the-blank questions, implementation questions, kind of like essay.
Wait, So when
number of questions, no, it doesn't match, because basically the real exam will have a total set of questions. I was only able to put half of the questions in the sample exam. The sample exam goal was really, I'm talking about the from Word to Blackboard. The sample exam on Blackboard is just as a trial for you to see if Lockdown Browser works. With the respect, is the real midterm like the sample midterm in Word? Yes, that's exactly how I'm looking at it. Like basically there will be questions that cover the first chapters that we covered up to today included in the real midterm. How many implementation questions will be there? I assume that about 80% of the exam will be multi-choice questions and only 20% will be implementation. So I assume that about 2 or 3 maximum. Okay. The implementation questions have partial credit, yes. Yes, you can still take the sample exam. In fact, I set it up, I think I set it up in such a way that you can take it as many times as you want. So maybe I set it up that way. Multiple attempts, yeah. For the real exam, you don't have multiple attempts. You basically finish, you submit, that's your exam. Okay, but the sample exam, if you want to take it 10 times, you can take it 10 times. Can we skip questions on the exam? All questions will be shown at once in the exam. So it's not that you go over question by question and you can't go back or anything like that. No, all questions are available from the beginning. From my experience, about every minute, the entire exam is saved. So basically, even in case that something happens, you will be able to at least get the answers that you submit, you basically didn't submit, but they were saved at some point. I basically made this sample exam on Sunday and I posted it on Sunday on Blackboard. It was due yesterday. Basically, I said they try to take the sample exam by yesterday, just to see if that works. So that's what I meant, that it was due yesterday. But it doesn't matter, you are not grading it. The midterm questions, will they be more difficult? About the same difficulty. Questions similar to the sample exam? Yes, but not the same. None of the questions in the sample exam is going to be in the real midterm. It's not an exercise in memorizing anything. We are doing programming, engineering, basically, in which you have to learn how to solve problems, not to remember anything. Any other questions?
Professor, where exactly do I download Respondus when I get to the Stony Brook website?
So there is a link pinned up in the midterm logistics, softweb.cc.stonybrook.edu. You enter your NetID and user, and you should be able to, one of the links there is the Respondus Lockdown Browser right here.
Gotcha, thank you.
And you can download it from there. So follow the instructions pinned up on the 1st of March in Blackboard.
All right, so when exactly is the official midterm?
The official midterm is during class time on Tuesday, March 9th.
All right, thank you so much.
Okay, good. So now let's return to the race chapter. Okay, so last time we learned how to write methods. Today we'll learn about arrays. So basically an array is the first data structure that we try to implement. It's a collection of elements that stay under one single variable. So let's start with an opening problem. We want to read 100 numbers, compute their average, and find how many numbers are above that average. For this problem, you really need to remember the numbers, because until you read the last number, you cannot know what's the average, because the average is the sum of all the numbers divided by the number of the numbers, 100. So even that one last number can modify the average quite a lot. The average could be lower, it could be higher, quite a lot. So, and then knowing the average, in order to find how many of the numbers were below the average or above the average, you need to iterate again over the numbers. So the problem is that you need to store and index all the numbers that were read. And one solution, one possible solution, is that you have a different variable for every number, N1 and 2 and 3 and 4 up to N100. And then for every one of them, you have to have an if statement. If that specific variable is less than the average or greater than the average, you increment the fact that it's above the average. So a program that does what I'm asking here would take about 500 lines of code if you do it with 100 variables, and then you read them, and then you compute them in an average, and then you iterate over each one of them to actually check if they are above or not the average. The simpler and the better, more efficient solution is that you have an array, one variable that stands for all of the 100 numbers. And we can access every one of those 100 numbers with an index. And we can find out if they are bigger or smaller than the average. Now, what is an array? An array is a data structure that represents a collection of elements of the same type of data. And I will explain to you why it's the same type in a few seconds. So first of all, how do you declare an array? An array can be declared by specifying the type of the elements, open close bracket. Basically, that stands that this is an array of doubles in this case. Then the variable of that type, myList, is an array of doubles. And we initialize the myList variable with a new double array of 10 elements. So we can actually see a couple of things. That first, we define the variable myList is an array reference. Then the actual object, which is an array of 10 elements, is created with a new operator in the heap, in the dynamic segment of memory. And that object basically contains at the beginning, there's 10 elements, all of them zero. We assign the reference of that array of 10 elements to the variable myList. So myList is a reference to the location where that array starts. The advantage of having the fact that there are of the same type of data is that we can find based on the index. So we can access every one of those elements given the index. Is it the first element in the array or the second element in the array, and so on, starting with index zero for the first element. Now, in order to find the location for an element like my list of 5, we take the address, the reference in my list, and we add to it the index multiplied with the size of an element. So now that's the reason why we have the same type of data, because we can, if we have the same type of data, we multiply the index like 5 with the size of an element. All of these have the same size because they are of the same type. Therefore, we can basically get, if this is an array of doubles, the reference plus 5 multiplied with 8, 40 bytes, would give me the beginning of the element with index 5. And now I can use that variable as I would use any variable in Java. I can assign to it 34.33, or I can read the value from that variable. I can system out println my list of 5. So really, what I can do is to access the element and assign or read that element from memory. Okay. I see there are a bunch of questions in the chat. So what would be a collection of different types of data? For instance, an array list. So an array list is stored in a different way. You have a reference to an array of references, and every element is basically an address to a different object in memory. So arrays in Java, they are not like array lists. You basically, the array is a reference, and if the array is of a primitive type data, then you would basically have this array. Now, this array, initially, the array is initialized with zero. So for instance, arrays are initialized with default values, and then you can assign values to those elements. Like for instance, we can assign to my list of 5, 34.33. Yes, we'll define brackets. We'll use brackets to define arrays. Another thing about arrays is that once you declare an array, the size of the array is fixed. So you can't add elements to the array. The only way to have a bigger array is to create a bigger array, copy the elements from the old array into the new array, and then you have additional space for more elements. So arrays are fixed size, same type of data. Okay, talking about default values, let me tell you about first declaring arrays, initializing arrays, and then we have default values. So you can declare arrays in two different ways. You can declare arrays by specifying the data type of the elements, open close brackets for array, and then the array reference variable. So double array my list, this my list is an array of doubles. At this point is a null reference because we didn't assign to it any array in memory. So you can't access the elements in any way. There is a different way, another way to actually declare arrays allowed because of historical reasons. This was how you would define arrays in C, data type of the elements, then the array reference for the array, and then open close bracket. This is allowed because again, Java wanted that C programmers move to Java, but it's not preferred. The way that to standardize way to define variables in Java is that you specify the type completely, and then you specify the variable of that type. In the second notation down below, you can see that this is the type is interleaved with the variable name. So you have the type of the elements, then the variable name, then the fact that this is an array. But that is allowed in Java. Please don't use it. We don't like it. So double my list array is basically another way to specify arrays. You can use the one on the bottom for C. Yes, we are in Java here. Array, now you can create an array. And the standard way to create arrays is array reference is equal with a new data type of an array size. So for instance, my list now can be assigned the address of a new double array of 10 elements. In this array, I can use references to find the elements, and the references start with zero. So in this my list of 10 elements, my list of zero references the first element, and my list of 9 references the last element of the array. You can declare and create an array in one single step, in one statement. For instance, data type array reference is equal with a new array of the same data type elements of the given size, whatever size you want to declare it as. And here you see in one line, double array, my list is assigned with a new double array of 10 elements. And given the old style, you can also use the declaration of the variable that way, double my list array. But again, that's not preferred. It's allowed, but not preferred. You can get the length of an array given basically the notation period length. So once the array is created, as I said, the size is fixed. You can't change it. You can find this size using the reference variable dot length. So basically the reference variable has a property which tells us what is the length of the array. It's actually stored in the array itself as a value right at the beginning of the array. For instance, mylist.length returns 10 because mylist was an array of 10 elements of the type double. And now we got to the default values. When an array is created, its elements are assigned default values. So 0 is assigned to all the numeric data types. So 0 for integers, all the integer types, and 0.0 for doubles and float. The character at Unicode 0 is for the character type, and false is for Boolean types. Okay. And for any kind of reference types, null, the null reference is basically the default value. I should probably add it here. And null for reference types. So for instance, if you have an array of strings, until you actually assign to every element a value, a string, they are just null, each one of them. Okay. So one thing about, so somebody said about .next, .next open close parentheses is that for length, you don't, it's not a function, it's a data field. So you don't have open close parentheses. It is like .character at with an index, like methods, but it's not actually a method, it's a data field. So you don't need open close parentheses.
Professor?
Yeah, go ahead.
So if you have a string array, mm-hmm. This with a length of 10, it would just have like 10 nulls inside until you write to it.
Exactly. So here we define a string array, string array SS, and is a new string array of 10 strings. And if you try to print one of them, system.out println SS of 0, it will print null, because basically it's SS is pointing to an array that basically has an array of nulls in it. See, null. Okay. Now, so given indices, you can access the elements of the array. They are zero base, they start from 0 to the length of the array minus 1. That's the element with, that's the index of the last element. Each element of the array is represented with an index variable, and it can be used for reading the value from that variable or assigning some value to that variable. It's really like a variable by itself. How do you use index variables? You basically use them as any other variables that you want. So here is an example. My list of 2 is assigned my list of 0 plus my list of 1. So what this basically does, it sums the first with the second element of the array and assigns the result to the third element of the array. So it's basically straightforward. You can use them on the left-hand side of an equality of an assignment, or on the right-hand side, you can use them in print statements. You can use them in any way that you would use a regular variable. You can also declare and initialize arrays in one step. Double array my list is equal with the list that the array that contains 1.9, 2.9, 3.4, and 3.5. This is just a shorthand syntax that internally it actually, it's basically expanded into my list is an array of 4 doubles, and my list of 0 is assigned 1.9, my list of 1 is assigned 2.9, my list of 2 is assigned 3.4, and my list of 3 is assigned 3.5. So basically, this is just a syntactic sugar. The first thing that happens when the Java compiles the program, if it finds any array initializer this way, it expands it into the verbose version. Okay.
Professor, quick question.
Yeah, go ahead.
In the previous slide, it said that my list 1 plus my list 2 would equal my list 3.
It's right? Assignment. Yeah.
Yeah, but like in the slide you were just showing, like numerically, it wasn't equivalent. So is it like in the screen, in the slide you were showing before this?
Okay. This one?
No, the other one. I think it's ahead. No, it was like you were talking about it when I asked the question.
I don't remember. I'm sorry.
Okay. All right.
So basically, let's do this example. Double array my list is equal with a new. Actually, let's just assign 1.2, 1, 2, 3, and 4. And now we basically say my list of 2 is assigned my list of 0 plus my list of 1. So my list of 0, and it happens that this is 1, this is 2, and 1 plus 2 is exactly 3. So my list of 2 is 3 already. So let's change, let's say that my list of this was 5. And now if we print it, system.out.print my list of 2, it will print 3, because 3 is actually the sum of 1 plus 2. So basically you can use the elements once the array is created in any way you want. You can use them to compute an expression and assign it to another element. Okay.
Professor, quick question.
Yeah.
Are arrays considered constructed objects?
Yes.
Or, okay.
So because basically this is an object, that's why you create them with a new operator. Double array of 4. And then you basically start filling in the data fields of that object. So internally, that statement that we had before would be my list of 0 is assigned 1, and my list of 1 is assigned 2, and so on.
Gotcha. So it'd be in the heap segment, right?
Yes. Yeah, all of these are in the heap segment. 5, and this is 4. Yeah. Okay, good. Okay, so let's see an example. So in this example, basically we have a small program in the main method. We declare an integer array values of 5 integers. At this point, basically values is a reference to an array in the heap that it contains 5 zeros, because they get default values and this is an array of integers. Okay, so now integer I is assigned 1, 1 less than 5 is true. So in this for loop, values of 1, the value of I, is assigned I plus values of I minus 1. So it's assigned 1 plus values of 1 minus 1, which is values of 0. So values of 1 is 1 plus values of 0. Values of 0 was 0. So 0 plus 1 is 1. Now I is incremented with 1, which I becomes 2. 2 less than 5 is still true. So values of 2 is assigned 2 plus values of 2 minus 1, which is 1. So basically, values of 2, which is this location, is assigned the previous value of 1 plus the index 2. So 1 plus 2 is 3. You can already see what's happening. Basically, at every step, we take the previous value, we add the index, and that would be the value of the current element. So let's see if that is the case. So we expect in the next step that we take 3 plus 3 is 6, and then 6 plus 4 is 10. So I is incremented from 2 to 3. 3 less than 5 is true. Values of 3 is assigned 3 plus values of 2. So values of 3, which is this location, is assigned the index 3 plus values of 2, which was 3, and that's 6. I is incremented from 3 to 4. 4 less than 5 is true. Values of 4 is assigned 4 plus values of 4 minus 1, which is values of 3. So 4 plus 6 is 10, and there's a value that is assigned to values of 4. I is incremented from 4 to 5. 5 less than 5 is false. So now values of 0 is assigned values of 1 plus values of 4. Values of 1 is 1, values of 4 is 10, so values of 0 is 11. So this is a simple example that we had a program and we analyzed what the program does. This is very good to try to trace this program on a piece of paper where you have the value of I and the values array. So you can basically change the values step by step so you can see what's happening. So that's basically what this program does. And it modifies an array of 5 integers. Now, you can initialize an array by asking the user to enter the values. Like in our opening problem, you define an array of doubles, then you define a scanner, ask the user to enter that number of doubles values. And then in a for loop, you iterate with the index from 0 to the length of the array. And you use the scanner to read every element in the array. My list of I is assigned input the next double. One thing to be careful about is that, in fact, every time you enter multiple integers, the cursor actually, or multiple numbers, the cursor goes one by one. So you can put them all in one line, type enter, and it reads all of them. Okay, let me actually show you. So let's assume that I wanted a double array of 4 elements. So now I want to read them from the user. So I write a for loop for integer I starting from 0. I is less than the length of that array, my list dot length. And I is incremented with 1 at every step. And now my list of I is assigned input dot next double. We need to define our scanner. You're right. So somewhere here at the beginning, I will define, first of all, we'll also have to prompt the user to enter the values. So scanner input, a new scanner for the input stream. And then we prompt the user to enter the values. So out.print. So here we say enter, and we have to specify exactly how many values. So we'll basically put here my list.length, and then we expect the user to enter 4 doubles. One thing that we can do is also to print the array after the user enters everything. So print array. Here we can basically print the array with a for loop. For, again, every integer I starting from 0, I is less than my list dot length, and I is incremented at every step. We'll have system.out.print. My list of I concatenated with a comma space. Okay. So now we can actually see how this works. So enter 4 numbers. So 1, 2, 3, 4. And they were all read and basically at once in this for loop. And we printed that the array was that basically array that was entered. If you don't want the user to enter numbers, you can actually generate random doubles. So another way to generate the array is my list of I is, let's say, math.random multiplied with 100 or 1,000. So let's multiply with 10, a smaller number. So this generates arrays with 4 random values. This is one of the utility functions that you have in homework 2. So basically, this is one array. Every time you run it, it's a different array. Okay. So basically, that's an array with 4 random doubles. So that's how you generate arrays with random values. Okay. Arrays are mutable. Exactly. That's completely true. That's why we are assigning values. Initially, the array was empty. And now it's mutable. So if I actually, the array is all zeros. So if I run this program, it prints that the array has 4 zeros. the moment that I actually modified them, I gave them random values, they are mutable. Okay, good. Exactly, that's exactly what this program does. It reads from the user 10 doubles, and then basically it prints them. Good. So initializing the array with random values, you iterate with a for loop over all the elements in the array, and you assign to every element math.random multiply with 100. So this will give to every element a random value. We did it in our quiz. How do you print arrays? Basically, again, you iterate with a for loop over the array from index 0 to the length of the array, strictly greater than I. And we'll print my list of I concatenated with a white space. And then you increment I after each iteration. So this prints the entire array in one line. Any questions? Okay. Summing all the elements in the array, or computing the maximum or the minimum of the elements of the array. So summing the elements, again, start with defining a variable total equal with 0. Then iterate over the elements of the array from I equals 0 to the length of the array, and add to the total the element at index I. After you compute this, after you finish the loop, you basically have the total, the sum of all the elements in the array. Okay, so let me show you an example. So for instance, in this example, I would like to do it when I generate the random number, so I don't do it separately. So double sum initially is assigned 0, and after the element is generated, the sum is incremented with the element, my list of I. Okay. So here is my list of I. Okay. Any questions? So now if I want actually to see what's the sum of those elements in the array, I can again have a print statement. So print, let's use println. And here to write that the sum, we need a new line because before we didn't have one. And here we can put the sum. And now again, run it. And here is the array, and the sum of the elements in the array is 26. Basically, those elements summed, the four elements is 26.68. Now, if you want to compute, let's say the minimum or the maximum, for that we need another loop. So let's define double minimum is my list of 0, and maybe also define the maximum is my list of 0. And now we can define a for loop for every integer I, starting from index 0, as long as I is less than my list dot length, we have I plus plus. We can actually write all in one if statement. So if the minimum is less than the current element, my list of I, then minimum is assigned my list of I. Else, we can actually do else if the maximum is greater than my list of I. If it's less than my list of I. And actually the same here, if the minimum was greater, then the minimum is not correct. And that's why we assign a different value to the minimum. So if the maximum is less than my list of I, then maximum should be my list of I. Okay. So now we can actually see if that worked properly. So in the same array was the minimum and the maximum. So we can actually see minimum is what and maximum is what. Max. So let's run again the program. And it basically generated random numbers. I have the sum, and it also tells me the minimum in that array is 0.3 and the maximum is 7.6, which seems to be correct. This was the minimum and this was the maximum. So that's basically how do we do largest element. We basically compare it with, we assign the first element. We don't, you can't assign zero because it may be that the random generated elements, they are all negative. And then you just say that this is the maximum, but that's not actually true. It could be that some negative number is the maximum. So you assign the first element, then you iterate over the rest of the elements. And if one of them is greater than the maximum, then the maximum is updated to the correct value. Okay. System.outprint total prints the total, basically the maximum. Can we add arrays of different lengths? Add them? Yes. So if you are meaning, can you use the same? All of these methods, they doesn't matter how big is the array. So because we've wrote all of them with mylist.length, you can basically make this array of two elements and everything works perfectly. You can make it of 2000 elements and everything works perfectly. We didn't actually consider how many elements were there. It could have been a million elements. Okay. Now, one question that is actually quite smart, if one asks, can you actually have an array of zero elements? What do you think? So let's see, where do I have? Here is the mistake. So the answer is yes, you can have an array of zero elements, but because here we are actually assigning to my list of zero, that doesn't basically work in that case. But if you just have an array of zero elements, that's possible. You can, it's an empty array. It doesn't have any elements. It doesn't have to have an element. Could be completely empty. Okay, good. Now, next problem, how do you generate a random permutation of the array? Random shuffling solves this. We iterate with an index over all elements of the array from index zero to the length of the array. For every index, we generate another random index, j, which is map.random multiplied with the length of the array, cast it to an integer. So this will give us a value between zero and the length of the array, not including the length of the array. When we cast it to an integer, we have from zero to the length of the array minus one included. Then we swap the two elements. You can swap the values in two variables with a temporary variable. So temp can be assigned my list of I. My list of I can now be used to copy the value of my list of j, and my list of j can be assigned the temporary value. So this is a way to generate a total random permutation. Okay, so let's implement this one too. Okay, so let's say that we have a random generator for an array of whatever number of elements we want. Actually, in order to see that is indeed an array, and we do get a random shuffling, let's actually create an array of 10 elements. And now let's implement random shuffling. So we said iterate over the indices from integer I equal with zero up to the length of the array, my list length. Now, for every element, generate another integer random j, which is the cast to integer of map.random multiply with the length of the array, my list length. Now, we need to swap the two elements. So we need to declare another temporary variable, which is assigned my list of I. And now my list of I can be assigned my list of J. Basically, it's like putting down on a table one object, some temporary space, taking the other object in the other hand, and then taking from the table the temporary element. Okay. So now actually let's see the output. I will use a method print that I will define myself. So print my list. Oops. And let's implement print. So I will implement it separately. So public static void print takes an array of doubles. And it prints it. So for every integer I from 0, I is less than my list length. We have system.out.print my list of I plus a space. Okay, so let's run this. And you see you get random permutations. Every time you run it, you get a different result because it's basically randomly permuting the elements. For every index, it generates another random index and swaps the two values in the array. And then we call the print method to print the array. Okay. If you directly cast math.random to int, it's zero because the value of math.random is from 0 to 1, not including 1. So if you cast it before you do the multiplication, you get 0 every time. So what we do, we multiply math.random with the length of the array. You get now from 0 included to the length of the array, open parentheses, not included. You cast it to integer and now you get integer indices from 0 to the length of the array minus 1. Good. So that's random shuffling. Shifting elements. So let's say that we want to shift all the elements to the left and take the first element and put it at the end. Or there is another option to shift all the elements to the right and take the last element and put it at the beginning. So we'll write two methods to do that. So the first method is shift left. So how does it work? We save the value of the first element into a variable. Let's call it temp. So temp is assigned the value of my list of 0. Then we write a loop. For every index from I equal 1, as long as I is less than the length of the array, my list of I minus 1 in the first case, if I equal with 1, is my list of 0, is assigned my list of I. So my list of 0 is assigned my list of 1. So we copy the second element into the first one. We increment I. Since I is still less than the length of the array, my list of I minus 1, which is now 2 minus 1 is 1. My list of 1 is assigned my list of 2. So basically, we copy one by one all of the elements up to the end of the array. At the end, after I finish this loop, the only thing that is left to be done is my list of the length of the array minus 1 is equal with the temp. So we basically take that value, temporary value, and we assign it into the last position. So this is shift left. For shift right, we do exactly the opposite. We basically save the last element into a temporary variable, and then we iterate from the end to the beginning, because if we iterate from the beginning by copying first into second, second into third, and so on, we actually copy the first element all the way to the beginning. Okay? So we'll start from the end, and we copy the previous to last element in the last element, then the next element into the previous to last element, and so on up to the beginning. So that's the shift left and shift right. So let's actually implement them both. So first we want the same array as we had before, but we are not going to do shuffling. Let's actually shift, implement the method. Shift left takes my list and we'll shift it left. So let's implement it. So public static void shift left, takes an array of doubles. Let's call it A, it's shorter to write. Now we can basically define temp. We can assign A of 0. And we can write our loop for every integer I, starting with 1, I is less than A dot length. And we hear A of I minus 1 is assigned the value of A of I. And finally, A dot length minus 1 is assigned temp. The last element will basically get a value. So for this array, shift left, we are expecting it to basically shift the entire array to the left. So 2 will become first element, 3 will become second element, and we want 1 to be at the end. That's exactly what this function does. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and then 1. So this was a correct shift left. Now let's try to implement a shift right in the same way. So public static void shift right. So we'll basically take 10, put it at the beginning, and then we'll have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 9, sorry. So now double array A. So I said for shift right, you have to save the last element first. So double temp is assigned A of A dot length minus 1. Then we write an inverse loop. So for every integer I, starting with A dot length minus 1. As long as I is greater than 0. And I is decremented with 1 at every step, A of I is assigned A of I minus 1. Now let's see if we did it correctly. So we'll need also A of 0 to be assigned temp. And we modify, instead of shift left, we call shift right. Okay. Run it. And we have 10, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 9. So basically what we did, we saved the last element. We've wrote a loop that iterates from the end to the beginning and decrements I at every step. A of I is assigned the value of A of I minus 1. So basically what we did in this array, we assigned to A of 9, which is the last element, A of 8. So we copied 9 into the position of 10. And then we decremented I and we copied 8 into the position of 9 and so on. So we copied from the end to the beginning, all the elements to the right with one position, including 1, we copied it into 2. And then we assigned to A of 0, 10, basically the last element. Okay. But you are assigning in a how shift right my list works. I'm not quite sure what you're asking. So basically in shift left, let me maybe write it as a comment. If you have an array like 1, 2, 3, you want to shift them left. So you would want to get as a result back 2, 3, and then 1 at the end. And for shift right, you will basically want, if you have the same array 1, 2, 3, shifting right will basically take the last element, put it at the beginning, and then you have 1 and 2. So basically what I do, I save 3, and then I start copying from the end to the beginning. I copy 2 into the first thing that it happens, it copies. Let me just show you the intermediate steps. So it copies 2 into the last position. Then it copies 1. So I have 1, 1, 2. And then I have the last step when I basically copy, I put in the first position the temporary value. What is print list? It's a method that we implemented here. We implemented this method about 10 minutes ago. Basically, it iterates over the elements of the array and prints every element.
I'm sorry, it's on line 10, print my list. Line 10, print my list, what does it exact do?
It calls this method.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
So this will call this method, print, that takes an array and iterates over the elements and prints them.
Thank you.
Welcome. The sample exam says, yes, shift right, but with n positions. So that's a good question. How do you shift with n positions? Like I want to shift right, but with three positions. So I can show you. So let's say I want another method, shift right by n. So how do we implement shift right by n? N being some number, let's say three times. Okay, three times. So we need shift right by n. Let me copy the definition of this method. So shift right by n being some number, integer n. The easiest solution is to write a loop for every integer I from 0 as long as I is less than n, I plus plus, call the other method, shift by 1, shift right, a. So this is basically what that method, you can, I'm using this other method as a helper method. You can actually do the same in the exam. You can use helper methods as long as you define them. So now what this method does, shifts by three positions or some number of positions. Basically what it does is shifts right, but n times, which basically shift by 1, n times exactly does shift by n. That's one way to do it. It's a very good way to do it because that way you basically implement the problem in a very simple way. So if I wanted shift by three positions, you can basically, I shift it by three, right? So 8, 9, 10 appear at the beginning and then I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So that's a good problem. Any other questions? Yeah, go ahead.
So essentially when you shift by n, you basically run the for loop n times?
N times by 1, exactly. Yeah, and that's actually my solution in the exam, in the sample exam. Good. Okay, now, in Java, we had the three types of loops, while loops, for loops, and do while loops. Java 1.5 introduced a new type of loop called the for each loop. And the for each loop, you basically have a single variable that allows you to traverse the complete array without an index. You define a new variable like double value in this array my list, and this value will iterate over all of the elements in my list from the beginning to the end. So instead of writing an index for integer I equal with 0, I less than the length of the list, and then access the elements with my list of I, what we do here, we basically iterate over my list, over the entire collection, by just giving a name to every element. Double value, you declare actually the variable value of the type double, and then you basically iterate over the array. Okay. Exactly. So many different languages work that way. They basically allow you to iterate over any collection using an iterator variable. The only thing in Java is that you get a copy of the value. So for instance, if you have an array of doubles, a primitive type array, you can only use the value to print it or to use it in an expression, like you can compute a sum of the elements. You cannot assign a new value. You can't modify the array in a for each loop, okay? So you still need to use index variables if you actually want to modify the elements of the array. You can use for each for different type of loops, like you can use a for each to compute the sum of the elements. So instead of writing the code on the left, you write the code on the right, which defines the variable total equal with zero, then a double D that iterates over the elements of my list, and the total is incremented with D at every step. So we don't need an index, because what we do, we bind the variable D to every element one by one in the array. But we actually just get a copy of the element from the array, okay? So in our program, I can modify my print statement. So my print, instead of writing this complex program that prints the elements, I can say for every double X in my list, print the double concatenate with the space. So it's basically, it works. I have a compilation error. It was X. That was the name that I gave to that variable. So basically everything is the same as before, with the exception that this is a for each loop. So for each loops are very useful. It makes your code more compact. You can use them for printing. You can use them for getting the values like a sum. This is that sum example. You can't use it for copying arrays. So let's talk about copying arrays first. So for instance, I want to duplicate an array. It's quite often that you have an array and you want to create a copy of that array. And the first idea for a programmer to say is that, why don't we just assign to list two, list one? Assignment actually just copies the reference. So remember what is in list one and list two, an address of the actual array in memory. So what happens is that, let's say list one was pointing to some array, list two was pointing to some other array. We've wrote list two is assigned list one. Now list two and list one are referencing to the same array. So now that's a problem, because you may modify with one variable the content of the array and the other variable sees that. That's not what we wanted. What we wanted was to duplicate the array, create a new copy of the array in a different location, and then basically modify that copy. So how can we do it? We can actually do it as follows. We can define a new array of the same size with the source array. So the source array was some random array. Target array is an array of integers, which is a new integer array of the same length with the source array. So when we declare and initialize the target, we declare that it is a new integer array of the same size of the source array. And then we iterate over the indices for every I from zero, as long as I is less than the length of the array, target of I is assigned source of I. So this makes a true copy. Basically, if I now modify target of I with doubling every element, that's not visible in the source, because it's a true new copy of the array. So let me show you an example. Here I have the main method. I can create a copy of my list. So double array my list two. It's a new double array of the same size, my list dot length. And now for every integer I, starting from zero, I is less than my list dot length. I is incremented with one at every step. My list of two of I is assigned my list of I. And now if I print my list two, I will see that I have the elements from 1 to 10. So it's really a way to copy the array. Now, there is actually a function in Java that already does that for you. So instead of iterating over the elements and copying them one by one, there is a function called system.arrayCopy that takes the source. So in the source in our case is my list, the position where I start copying in the source from position zero into the destination, my list two. From what position in the destination, from position zero, and the length is the number of elements that is going to be copied. So my list.length. So instead of writing those two lines that it's a for loop, I can actually use this array copy function and does exactly the same. It iterates over the elements. So one thing to be careful about is that array copy does not actually create the array. So you still need to create the array yourself of the same length with the original array. Array copy only iterates over the elements to copy the elements from the source to the destination and the number of elements. Okay. So that's basically the array copy utility. You can use it to copy arrays. Now, when you pass an array to a function, like for instance, a function of printing arrays, print array, you pass an array and you print the elements of the array. Now, you can pass an array that was already created, or you can create an anonymous array, an array that has no name in the main method or in the method that invokes the other method. And that's a new integer array of 3, 2, 3, 1, 2, and so on. So it's really, there is a way in Java to create arrays on the fly anytime you want. It's like the synthetic sugar that is used for creating a new array and passing it as a parameter. So that statement that you saw before creates an array, and that's, there is no reference to that array. We just specify the type of the array and the elements of the array. It's called an anonymous array. It's created on the fly and passed to the function. Now, Java passes values by a method called call by value, meaning that you copy the value from the element, the argument, into the formal parameter. For a primitive type variable, the actual value is passed, meaning that you copy one or two from the variable into the variable that is in the method, the formal parameter. If you change the value of the formal parameter, it doesn't change the value of the actual parameter, the argument in the main method. For arrays, because of the fact that when you copy the array variable, you actually copy the same reference in the formal parameter, the formal parameter refers to the same array object. Okay, so if you modify the array elements, you actually modify the original array. So let me show you an example. So we have a main method in which we define an integer primitive type variable equal with one, x equal with one. And we define an integer array y that is an array of 10 elements, 10 integers. Initially, they are all zero, okay? We invoke the method m with x and y. So x, which is one, is copied into the method m, which into the variable, the formal parameter number. Y is copied into numbers. X was just an integer, like one. Y is the address of an object in memory. So the same address is copied in numbers. In the variable, in the method M, we assign to number 1001. And to numbers of zero, this array, we use the index variable index zero, we assign 5555. And we finish the method M. We return back to the main method here, and we print out the value of X and the value of Y of zero. So now think, if X was passed by value, was just copied in number, what is the value of X after we return from the method? So what is the value of X that will be printed X was copied into number, number was modified. We came back to the main method. What's the value of X? Anyone? Chiwei is right. Basically, X is 1, the original value of X, because it was only copied into number. Number was modified. We return back to the main method. X is still 1. So it remains the same. Now, what is the value of Y of 0? So Y was a reference. It was copied in numbers. And now in that method, numbers of 0 was equal 5,555. And we return back in the main method and we print out Y of 0 is what value? Anyone? Junlin, you're right, 5,555. So why is this the case? Look at the stack. So we are in the main method. We started the program. X was initialized with 1. Y was a reference to an array of 10 integers. Okay. Now we call the method M. So the method M is called. We copy both X and Y into the variables for number and numbers. Number is originally 1, and then we assign 1001 to it. Numbers is the same reference, the same address that was in Y, and we copied in numbers. So both numbers and X and Y are pointing to the same array on the heap. So now if I modify numbers of 0 is assigned 5,555, after I finish the method M and I return to the main method and I print Y of 0, it still prints 5,555. So the difference is that X was a primitive type variable. It keeps the value in the variable itself on the stack. And so is number. While Y and numbers are references. So when I modify Y of 0 or numbers of 0, it modifies the same object that is referenced by both variables. So that's the difference between reference type variables and primitive type variables, like the integer X, okay? And that's why I was able to write all of these methods that you saw before, shift left, by just passing the array, not returning anything, but then internally doing some shifting inside the array itself. Because basically I have a reference to the same array, so any changes that I make in this method, it changes that array. So that's the thing with passing arrays as references to a method, that you can modify in the method the array. Okay. So that's basically the point with arrays and modifying the arrays in memory. So let's see some examples. The first one is, let's write a reverse method that reverses an integer array. So it takes an array of integers. Internally, it creates a new array, result of the same length with the array of integers. I have one for loop that uses two variables, I is equal with 0, and j is equal with the length of the array, result minus 1. So I is the index of the first position in list, and j is the index of the last position in result. As long as I is less than the length of the array, the result of j is assigned the list of I, and I increment I and I decrement j. So let's see what happens. Basically, for I equal with 0, result of j, which is the length minus 1, is assigned list of 0. So basically, I copy the first element into the last element of the result. I increment I with 1. So basically, I is now 2, and j with 1. So j is the index of the element prior to the last element. And then again, I assign the second element to the second from the end element of the result. And I iterate, I do this as long as I is less than length. The only difference from a normal loop is the fact that I have two variables and two expressions, two statements that are executed after each iteration. So I separate them with comma, saying that these are, I increment I and I decrement j. Okay. And here is an example. I have list one, which was an array. List two is the result of reverse of list one, which reverses the list and creates a new list result and returns the list of the elements in reverse order. Now here is how does this work step by step. So basically, result is created and it's an array of zeros of the same length with list. I is assigned 0 and j is assigned 5. So 0 is less than 6 is true. So now result of 5 is assigned list of 0. Basically, we copy the element, the first element of list, into the last position of the result. We decrement increment I and decrement j. And now, since I is 1, result of 4 is assigned list of 1. So we copy the 2 into the previous to last position. And we continue. We increment I to 3. We decrement j to 3. And 3 is less than 6. Result of 3 is assigned a list of 2. So this continues. And it goes up to copying the last element list of 5 into result of 0. And we return the result reference. So basically the reference that was to the new array is now copied into list of 0. Okay. You can also do a reverse in place. So you can basically return void for reverse. And then all that you basically are doing are swapping the elements. So you start with 0 and there is length minus 1 as the two indices. You assign to a temporary variable list of j, then list of j can be assigned list of I, and list of I it can be assigned temp. You only go up to the length of the array divided by 2, because basically you go to the middle and you swap all the elements corresponding to each other. When you reach in the middle, you are done. If you continue up to the end of the array, you swap them back. So be very careful about that. So this is important. You go to the middle and then the elements are swapped because we have two assignments here for every element. You have this assignment and this assignment. Okay. So really you should go up to the middle. Any questions up to now? Two more methods. Searching an array. So the process of looking for a specific element of the array and return the index in that array of that element. So linear search takes a random array, doesn't have to be sorted, and a key. And the idea is to return the first index of an element in the array that is equal with a key. And the process is quite simple. You iterate from the first position to the end of the array, and you return the index of the first element that is equal with the key. The implementation is quite simple. Basically, the linear search takes an array and a key. The for loop iterates from 0 to the length of the list. If the key is equal with list of I, then we return the index I. If we finish the for loop and we didn't find the element, we return minus 1, stating that there is no such element, like for instance, minus 4 in that array. If the array is sorted, there is a better method. So think of a phone book. You're not going to start from the beginning and read all the names if you're looking for a specific name. You usually open in the middle, you see, is my name greater than, or the key that you're looking for greater than the middle? And then you go in the second half and open in the middle and so on. This is binary search. If the array is already sorted, then it's cheaper to find an element by in ascending order, by comparing the key with the element in the middle and discard half of the array. If the key is greater than the element in the middle, by transitivity is greater than all of the preceding elements because the array is sorted. So you basically now have only half of the array to look over. So this is exactly the three cases. You look in the middle, you compare with the key, And then you basically, if it's greater than the middle element, you discard the first half. If it's less than the middle element, then you discard the second half. If it's equal, you return the index. So the implementation is quite simple. Let me just go. Actually, I should probably stop here. It's 6:05. So we'll continue from search, binary search after the midterm. So the midterm will be the topics of the midterm. Let me update this where we stop today. Is actually, this is the wrong class. The topics of the midterm are up to linear search in an array included. Everything else will be after the midterm. So let me actually give you exactly the page number up to page 76, slide 76. Arrays included. Everything else that was covered up to now is going to be tested in the midterm. Any questions? Arrays will be on the midterm up to linear search, which is on slide 76. Okay. That's all for today. Good luck in the midterm. Bye, everyone.
Professor, have a great weekend.
You too.
Thank you, Professor.
Thank you, Professor. Have a great
day. Thank you, Professor.
Bye.